What's up, you beautiful bastards? Hope you're having a fantastic Thursday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show, and let's just jump into it. And the first thing we need to talk about today is the K-pop world, and it's not, you know, that happy, fluffy news like, oh my god, BTS broke a new record on YouTube. This is more in line and actually connected to the troubling K-pop news we talked about last week. Today, another K-pop star has found themselves in serious legal trouble, and that star in question is 30-year-old singer-songwriter Jung Joon-young, who is best known for his part in an extremely popular Korean variety show. And his troubles began on March 11th, when the South Korean broadcaster SBS revealed that Seoul police discovered that between 2015 and 2016, he illegally shared sexually explicit videos of women taken without their knowledge or consent in a group chat. Something that he had actually been accused of doing by an ex-girlfriend back in 2016, but there she ultimately rescinded her accusations. And so what we saw was that police wouldn't officially open a separate investigation into Jung until March 14th. But that brings up the question, why now? Why were police even looking into his messages? Well, actually, they weren't. Jung's alleged crimes were discovered on accident by police as part of their investigation into fellow K-pop star Seungri, who we covered last week. And if you missed that, you want to catch up on that, I'll link to it down below, but all you really need to know for now is that back in 2015, Seungri was part of a group chat that indicated he was organizing a sex for business scheme where he would essentially offer sexual encounters with women to help persuade potential investors. Police have been investigating that and a growing list of other crimes. There's also accusations of a lot of corruption, but also to be clear, because there has been some confusion, Jung's sex video messages and Seungri's sexual bribery messages weren't actually in the same group chat. Also, since the initial reports about this, more details have come out. Reportedly, upwards of 10 women were filmed having sex with Jung without their knowledge or consent, and it appears that Jung was the ringleader in this whole group chat, which has sparked an investigation into a possible spy cam porn scheme. Other members of the chat include Seungri, as well as Lee Jung-hyun of CNBLUE, Choi Jung-hoon of FT Island, and Yang Jun-hyung of Highlight. Now, unlike Seungri's crimes, which sparked off massive investigations into multiple categories of crimes, this investigation reportedly won't require a ton of resources. And that's because just a couple of days after the SBS report came out, Jung largely admitted to the crimes in an official statement he released via his music label, saying, in regards to what is being said in relation to me, I admit to all my crimes. I filmed women without their consent and shared it in a social media chat room, and while I did so, I didn't feel a great sense of guilt. More than anyone else, I apologize to the women who have experienced great suffering due to my actions, to the many people who must feel anger even more so than disappointment, and to the many people who made me into a public figure and cherished me. I will sincerely take part without any falsehoods in the investigations that will begin on the morning of March 14th, and I will accept punishment for my actions. And in that statement, he also announced that he would be withdrawing from all programs he was meant to appear on, and seemingly retire from entertainment. Then, the next thing we see, police request an arrest warrant. Jung and police appear before a prosecutor. Jung apologizes once again. What followed was Jung was taken into police custody, he was arrested, and he left the courthouse in handcuffs. Now, along with this story, I mean, the investigations into the Korean entertainment industry has put on display this kind of open secret in Korea, that many stars have gotten away with blatant crimes and with the possible help from authorities. But at least right now, for now, it seems that South Korea plans on taking this far more seriously. President Moon Jae-in has called for a thorough investigation into allegations that police and tax officials turned a blind eye to illegal activities like the one Seungri was accused of doing. Also, one of the spin-offs of the investigations into Seungri is whether or not local police took bribes to ignore the drug and sex crimes as nightclubs are accused of doing. And there, so far, you have one police officer that has been accused of accepting bribes from Seungri. And of note, the corruption investigations have even led to the arrests of other K-pop stars. Today, Choi Jung-hoon, the leader of FT Island and a member of Jung's group chat, was arrested for attempting to bribe police back in 2016 to cover up a drunk driving incident. And all of these crimes have also had consequences for people in the industry. First off, Korean music labels have largely seen shares fall in the past 2 weeks, affecting people who likely weren't involved in any crime. Many of the labels, like YG Entertainment, which represents Seungri, have tried to apologize that they didn't have more control over their artists. They are also among the worst hit, with their shares falling about 20% in the past month. And in addition to that, they're also facing a lawsuit by civic groups and shareholders for a, quote, lack of ethics and morality. We've also seen women in the industry being hit with fallout from these controversies. For example, you have people like Lee Seungri, also known as Nancy from Momoland. She's actually had to change her name online to Ego Root, and that was because of the simple and unfortunate coincidence that her posts, her name, was being mixed in with negative posts against Seungri. But this situation has also highlighted something that's affected women outside of the industry as well. For years, you've had women in Korea protesting that people were filming them in secret, which is a major problem in the country. It's why last year we saw tens of thousands of women taking to the streets in Korea to protest this problem. And you know, there was even a story about this in the past 24 hours. Reportedly, four men were arrested in Korea for setting up hidden cameras in random hotel rooms and live streaming it. According to the report, there were around 1,600 victims, their site had around 4,000 active viewers at any given time. But for now, that is where we're gonna end this story. That's the main story, some of the other things that we're seeing in Korea right now. And of course, I wanna pass the question off to you. What are your thoughts around this? What does this make you feel? But from that, I wanna share some stuff I love today and today in awesome, brought to you by Postmates and PostDeFranco.com. And Postmates, if you don't know, is the fantastic delivery on demand service. You want something from the store, your favorite restaurant, you wanna snag some adult beverages, perhaps. They'll deliver it to your house, house, your work, your wherever, you just open up the app, select, go. It is a fantastic convenience that I feel like has saved me countless of hours in my everyday life. And best of all, if you download the app, which you can get by clicking the link down below, going to posttofranco.com, once you have it, make sure you enter in promo code PhillyD because they'll give you $100 in free delivery fee credit. And the first bit of awesome is that beautiful bastard where we sell our high quality, ethically sourced, handmade in the USA pomades, beard oils, lip balms, even candles, which you can still snag right now at beautifulbastard.com, although understand it is handmade, so it's first come, first serve. There's a little delay right now, but over on the Instagram, we're giving away free product to one lucky person. I'll link to it down below. Definitely follow and check it out. Then, oh man, I got so excited when I saw this came out this morning. We got a trailer for John Wick 3. I am just so pumped for this movie. We also had Markiplier answering the web's most searched questions. We had Theo Vaughn on Hot Ones. We had Life Noggin asking and answering what if everyone went to sleep at the same time. And if you want to see the full versions of everything I just shared, the secret link of the day, really anything at all, links as always are in the description down below. And then I wanted to give you guys an update around the horror story that we talked about yesterday involving Fantastic Adventures. That was a YouTube family channel that belonged to an Arizona woman by the name of Michelle Hackney. She was arrested on 7 counts of child abuse, 5 counts of unlawful imprisonment, 5 counts of child neglect, and 2 counts of child molestation. This because she allegedly forced her 7 adopted children to make YouTube sketch videos. And according to the reports on this, she was pulling kids out of school, forcing them to make these YouTube videos, punishing them if they messed up. And punish isn't even the right word because the allegations involved just straight up abuse. Allegations like she pepper sprayed the kids from head to toe, she'd lock them in closets, there's ice baths, she would touch them inappropriately. Just horrible, and we talked about her arrest and that the channel had been demonetized. But yesterday when we talked about this, we compared it to other situations where there were charges, there were accusations, there was no conviction yet. But the update is, YouTube has removed the channel, they've deleted it. When you go to the page, it says, this account has been terminated for violating YouTube's community guidelines. As of right now, since you have allegations, you have charges, it's unclear what YouTube community guidelines they are saying were breached. But seemingly here, YouTube had a change of heart, or they found content that could technically violate the rules and give them justification. And personally, I will say I am happy that this channel has been removed, given the specifics that authorities said they found when they went there, given the fact that one of Hackney's adult sons who was arrested said there was abuse, they just didn't know if they should report to police, and they never did. It appeared that there was a lot of validity to these abuse claims, and really, if you think about it, the videos that were still on the site, it was videos of kids being abused to do those things. But yeah, there was that update. And the last thing we're gonna talk about today is a massive update regarding New Zealand. As I'm sure you remember, last Friday, New Zealand suffered a horrible tragedy when 50 people were killed at 2 mosques in Christchurch. Since the attack, we've seen people in New Zealand and out rally together to support the victims, the families. Earlier this week, we saw Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern vow to never say the shooter's name. And now, 6 days after the shooting, she has announced a national ban on the weapons that were used in the attack. And here she is announcing it in a recent press conference.
Today I'm announcing that New Zealand will ban all military-style semi-automatic weapons. We will also ban all assault rifles. We will ban all high-capacity magazines. We will ban all parts with the ability to convert semi-automatic or any other type of firearm into a military-style semi-automatic weapon. We will ban parts that cause a firearm to generate semi-automatic, automatic, or close to automatic gunfire. In short, every semi-automatic weapon used in the terrorist attack on Friday will be banned in this country.
According to authorities, there are between 1.2 to 1.5 million guns circulating in New Zealand, and Ardern has said the government is working on a large-scale buyback plan for citizens who have the weapons affected by the ban, saying that the plan is for the guns to be surrendered to police, eventually destroyed, and once the buyback is complete, the owners would receive fair and reasonable compensation, although she didn't really elaborate on that, but she did estimate that the buyback plan could cost between $100 to $200 million. Police Minister Stuart Nash also said that the bill would include narrow exemptions for police and defense forces, and exemptions for other, quote, legitimate business uses like professional pest control, saying some guns serve legitimate purposes in our farming communities. More specifically, the bill will reportedly make exemptions for .22 caliber semi-automatic rimfire weapons with magazines holding no more than 10 rounds, and semi-automatic and pump-action shotguns with non-detachable tubular magazines holding no more than 5 rounds. And connecting it to the previous reference, both of those guns are commonly used by farmers and hunters. And Ash also said that immediate action would be taken to prevent people from stockpiling weapons ahead of the change of the law, as well as action to encourage gun owners to surrender their weapons. And as far as what comes next, the gun gun reform proposal will be introduced to Parliament in the first week of April, and for it to go into effect, lawmakers will need to vote on amending the existing legislation, which is the Arms Act of 1983. According to reports, Ardern is expected to face minimal resistance in Parliament, and she even expects the law to take effect by April 11. Also, New Zealand Governor General Patsy Reddy has also signed an order to reclassify some semi-automatic weapons as military style. So, as a result of that, many people who legally own certain firearms will no longer be able to have them on their existing license conditions. And as far as people turning their weapons over, Police Commissioner Mike Bush said that gun drops would be set up at police stations so citizens could safely hand in guns, adding, "I can't emphasize enough that in the current environment, it is important you do not take your now unlawful firearm anywhere without notifying police. It is absolutely vital that we manage the safe and organized transport of all firearms into police custody." And as far as what happens after what Ardern calls a reasonable period for returns has passed, anyone with these specific weapons could face fines of up to $4,000 and or 3 years in prison. However, on that note, the draft legislation actually being proposed right now has even stiffer measures. And as far as the reaction to this, for the most part, Ardern's announcement has been met with tons of support. According to local reports, almost 70,000 New Zealanders signed petitions calling for gun control reform. The decision has also been welcomed by New Zealand's Police Association, and very interestingly, the lobbying group Federated Farmers even issued a statement saying, "This will not be popular among some of our members, but after a week of intense debate and careful consideration by our elected representatives and staff, we believe this is the only practicable solution. We are trying to tread a responsible path. The wrong guns can't be allowed to get into the wrong hands." Even opposition leader Simon Bridges said his national party supported the proposed changes, saying, "The terrorist attack in Christchurch last week has changed us as a nation. National has been clear since this devastating attack that we support changes to our regime and that we will work constructively with the government. We agree that the public doesn't need access to military-style semi-automatic weapons. National supports them being banned along with assault rifles." Adding, "We also support the government's proposals to limit the access to other high-powered semi-automatic weapons and ammunition. We remain committed to ensuring the safety of New Zealanders and fighting extremism in all forms. National will work constructively with the government to ensure we get this right." But I also do want to note that the country's Council of Licensed Firearms Owners said in a Facebook post to members that it will consider these implications and make a statement very soon, also adding that they are working incredibly hard to understand and manage this set of circumstances. And also of note here is after this just horrible tragedy and the actions that we're seeing now, where we're having a lot of people comparing and contrasting. People comparing New Zealand to what happened in Australia after the 1996 Port Arthur massacre. There, after Australia implemented their ban, the country destroyed more than a million weapons, and there were additional gun buybacks and amnesties that have been conducted since. And meanwhile, people have been pointing out that what's happening in New Zealand stands in stark contrast to what happens in the United States, which is why we saw people like Bernie Sanders tweeting, "This is what real action to stop gun violence looks like. We must follow New Zealand's lead, take on the NRA, and ban the sale and distribution of assault weapons in the United States." But meanwhile, on the other side of that, you had people like NRA spokesperson Dana Lash citing the Second Amendment and saying, "First define, quote, assault weapon. Words are important and certain laws come into play depending on which words are used, so define this. Secondly, the United States isn't New Zealand. While they do not have an inalienable right to bear arms and to self-defense, we do." You know, that's where we are with this story now. Those are some of the takes, and I pass the question off to you. What do you think about this move in New Zealand and the aftermath of this horrible tragedy there? Let me know what you think about this story, what you're feeling about this story. Also, where are you from? I know we have a bunch of different people in our audience from all different places, and a lot of people have different relationships with weapons. Yeah, let me know in those comments down below. And that's where we're going to end today's show. And of course, if you like this video, hit that like button. Don't deny yourself. If you're new here, you want more of this, be sure to subscribe. Also, if you missed yesterday's Philip DeFranco show or this morning's Extra Morning News deep dive and you want to catch up on either, you can click or tap right there to watch those. But with that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.